Good morning and welcome to Hope Fellowship. We are glad that you've joined us online this morning. And as we begin our time of worship, my name is John Trott and I'm one of the pastors here. And I'd like to read from Psalm 108. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great above the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Well, let's join together and sing praises to our Lord and Savior.
Us when we fell away, poured mercy on our souls, and promised grace would come to save, to loose death's iron hold. You are our song from age to age, our voices unite to recount your praise again and again. God of promises fulfilled, the God who took on flesh, who did all that the Father willed, was humbled unto death. You bore our cross of sin and shame, endured our agony, and gladness we now bear your name, and worship at your feet. You are our song from age to age, our voices unite to recount your praise again and again. You are our song from age to age, we will proclaim your power to save again and again. Who surely guides our steps through tempest and through trials. Our Shepherd King, your way is best, though tears now veil our eyes. Your steadfast love, our perfect hope, our eyes are fixed on grace. We have no doubt you'll lead us home, finally see your face. You are our song from age to age, our voices unite to recount your praise again and again. You are our song from age to age, we will proclaim your power to save again. God of all of history, enthroned in realms of light, what eyes of faith have strained to see will one day fill our sight. With all the saints we'll lay our crowns before the Savior's feet. Sing as all the heavens resound, for all eternity. You are our song from age to age, our voices unite to recount your praise again and again. You are our song from age to age, we will proclaim your power to save.
Well, will you join me for a word of prayer as we are preparing this week to celebrate Thanksgiving? And for many of us, it may look a lot different, but we still have so much to be thankful for. So will you bow your heads with me as I lead us in a time of prayer? Father God, I thank you so much for this opportunity to be gathered together, even though it's online and we wish that we could be in person. But Father, as we stop and settle our minds, think about all that you have done for us in this year. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. You have sustained us. You have brought us through a number of different things, and yet you are the same God yesterday, today, and forever. And we rejoice in that. In the midst of some chaos, in the midst of struggling and difficulties, we can turn to you and need to turn to you because, Lord, you never change. You are good, and you have given to us so much that we can be thankful for. We're thankful for the space that we've been able to use. We're thankful for technology and the way we're able to even meet online this week and in the coming weeks. Father, we thank you so much for the way in which we can still be gathered in listening to and hearing the same message, the same songs, in that as we talk with one another, whether it's texting or FaceTime, maybe even seeing each other, that we have the commonality still of you and that we can talk about similar things. Father, I pray that you would just be with each one, each family this week, as we enter a time of Thanksgiving, and for many, it's going to be and look very different. And Father, even though our circumstances have changed, help us to look to you. Help us to look to the one who sustains us, who holds us up, and to the one who has given us new life. And then after Thanksgiving, as we enter into the time of Christmas, that we're going to have the 4 weeks of Advent and have a lot of time to focus in on the wonderful gift of your Son. May we not lose sight of that even during this week. Father, we just pray for Pastor Jeff as he'll bring forth the message today, that you would use him and use your word to challenge us. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
Well, good morning, Hope. My name is Jeff Brewer, and I'm one of the pastors here at Hope. And we delight in being able to gather together normally. We've had to go back to online only. We want to be as cautious and safe as possible, especially in light of the guidelines, in particular with many of the businesses and having to go back to 25% capacity. And so we look forward to being able to meet together again. We're shooting tentatively towards January 10th and being able to do that. We'll be gathering online here as well as in our mission groups. And so if you're new to Hope, and you would like more information, you can send an email to our info@myhopefellowship.org. If you'd just like to pray with someone and have the pastors and the elders be praying for you, we would like to do that. And so would you listen with me to Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21 for our scripture reading and our sermon text here this morning. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, may he equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Would you pray with me? Father, we do long to be able to be together. I long to be able to preach the word to people who are sitting and listening and that I can see, knowing the relationship that we have. And so, Father, we pray that even in this opportunity where we have to, where I preach to this empty room and you use your word even on Sunday mornings as people gather in their homes, Father, we pray for a special work for you by your Holy Spirit. Pray that for me now as I preach, that your word would be clear. Pray, Father, for our families who are sitting together, who are listening. May you be honored. May you be glorified, and may the words of my mouth, meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. We pray these things. Amen. Well, on most normal years, I'm guessing that a lot of us take time around the Thanksgiving table to be recounting what we're thankful for. Now, some family members, you know who I'm looking at, Brewer clan, extended Brewer clan. They're fidgeting anxiously, kind of wondering how long is this going to go on so that the turkey and the noodles and the gravy and everything doesn't get cold. As people kind of go around the table and they're kind of recounting what they're thankful for. And it's the usual fare. I'm sure your family's like ours. Thankful for family. Thank you. Thankful for our kids. Thank you. Thankful for our jobs or grandkids, the grandparents might say. And it's a part of the comfort of traditions. But sadly, I think that can become a part of our blurring together of holidays year after year spent the same way. You know, recently we've probably added to around your table people talking about Thanksgiving night and the usual groans of family members remarking that we can't even be thankful for one whole day anymore. Until this year. Now, I'm not sure what your Thanksgiving is going to look like, but ours certainly looks different than what we would have expected last Thanksgiving. There's no travel, no grandparents or great-grandparents, no adult table or kids table, and even kind of, you can gasp here, there won't be stores opening up for doorbuster extravaganzas, which I think presumably gives us more time to pause and for us, since everything's out of the ordinary, since it's not business as usual on Thanksgiving, I think it gives us the opportunity to pause and to really reflect about what we're thankful for in the midst of what has been a difficult and painful year and continues to be so. And so in that way, I'm thankful that we've come today to the end of Hebrews and to the benediction for this Sunday before Thanksgiving, because I think it helps us to focus our eyes on how we can be thankful for what God has done for us in Christ. In a letter that has continually, like last week, we looked at kind of the overview of the entire book of Hebrews, and we looked at how Jesus is supreme, how he's greater than angels, he's greater than Moses, he's greater than the Levitical priests, he's greater than the great high priest. All of these ways we saw Jesus is supreme. And in this benediction, which is just a benediction, just simply means a prayer for of blessing, we're essentially the hearers of this book, of this message, are being sent out confident of the blessings of God that are in Christ, that Jesus is supreme, and now they can live in light of those blessings of this sovereign King. And so my aim here this morning is that our hearts be centered on how we can be thankful for what Christ has done for what God has done for us in Christ. And so I just want us to look at four simple things, four ways that these two verses help us be thankful for God's blessings towards us in Christ. So four ways we can be thankful. So look, if it's hard to kind of figure out what we're thankful for, and it's not business as usual thinking about that, I think the book of Hebrews right here, it gives us an opportunity to be thankful in a very specific way for what God's done for us in Christ. So that's my aim and that's my goal here. So let's think first here. Blessing number one we should be thankful for. God has secured peace through the blood of his Son. So blessing number one that we should be thankful for, God has secured peace through the blood of his Son. You know, I read this week about how in 1943, right during the height of World War II, the Thanksgiving holiday looked completely different. Actually, Norman Rockwell painted his famous Thanksgiving portrait on that Thanksgiving in 1943 to try to remind people of the way it used to be. Not only were so many people stationed overseas, but families had a hard time getting together that year as well because of gasoline rationing and all the other rations that were taking place in the midst of the war. Even the traditional Thanksgiving Day football game looked different because so many pro football teams had to either close or they were greatly reduced because of all the men serving overseas. And it actually, I learned this first time this week, that it forced the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Philadelphia Eagles to combine, and they actually formed a team called the Steagles, you can't make this up, so they could play. And so in those years, like in 1943, in the midst of World War II, people were longing for peace. They were longing for a true peace, more than just a mere sentiment, not peace on earth, goodwill to men, but one that represented the end of war. Now, when we look at Hebrews chapter 13, and we see in verse 20 how the author of Hebrews begins, "Now may the God of peace." He's doing a couple things there. He's signaling, as was traditional at the kind of the end of Jewish letters, this was the end of the letter. This benediction, there's some housekeeping things right at the end of the letter, but last few verses, but this is really the end of the letter, and he's signaling that by saying, "Now may the God of peace." But what he's also doing is he's giving this title to God, the God of peace, so that we can be reminded of who this God is. Not just its closing greeting and so kind of start being ready to take off and to leave, but it's meant for us to be thinking about a God who's brought peace through his Son that's been so talked about all through the book of Hebrews. And so we need to be thankful in the way that people were when that war was over and peace had been secured at the end of World War II. That's the kind of thankfulness we need to be thinking about when we hear God of peace, because this is a God who has made peace through his Son. So a couple other places the God of peace is used in the New Testament. I think they're interesting and encouraging to think about. Romans 16:20, it says, "Now the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet." God makes peace through the defeat of evil. In 1 Corinthians 14:33, the God of peace is used in a little bit different way. Here's what Paul writes there. He says, "For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace." Now, in 1 Corinthians, it was in the context of disorder. Talking about orderly worship, and specifically the usage of revelations and tongues and interpretation. And the overall principle that Paul's wanting to talk about there in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 is that all things are being done for building up. And if it's done in a disorderly or if it's done in a confusing way, nobody's helped. So peace there, God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. that's being used in the sense of orderliness, in the sense of chaos. So now put these together. When we talk about God being the God of peace, he's not only the God who conquers evil, but he's also the God who brings order out of chaos. All of the disorder that sin caused, when as Romans tells us, the cosmos, as it were, all of creation was thrown into the bondage of decay, and it's groaning, waiting for the liberation of the sons of man. When all of this happened, creation and our very lives and hearts and everything was thrown into chaos. So the God who makes peace, he is the one who brings order out of chaos, and he does that through his Son. Now look at the end of verse 20. By the blood of the eternal covenant. Now that little word "by" there is important. It's getting at the sense of because of the blood of the eternal covenant, or on the basis of the blood of the eternal covenant. So how did God make peace? He is the God of peace who has made peace on the basis of the blood shed by Christ of the eternal covenant, that which he has promised beforehand and fulfilled in Christ. And so the only end to being at war with God, the only way for chaos to be brought into subjection in orderliness of order, is through the Son who made peace by the blood of his cross. And so blessing number one that we can be thankful for: God has secured peace through the blood of his Son. Blessing number two that we should be thankful for: God has raised his Son from the dead. Now look again at verse 20. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus. Now, it might seem difficult to get your minds around here, but this is the very first time in the entire book of Hebrews, with all of its dense theology, all of the ways in which he's talking about how Jesus is supreme, this is the very first time that the resurrection is explicitly mentioned. Look, I mean, just get your minds around that. The resurrection is critically important, and yet, this is the first time it's explicitly mentioned. Now, I think it would be an overstatement to say this is the only time that he talks about the resurrection, because throughout the book, the book of Hebrews hinges on the fact that Jesus is supreme and has shown he's greater than angels, he's greater than Moses, he's greater than these other priests who live and continually are making sacrifices and who die, but yet Jesus, who makes the sacrifice eternally. So the resurrection is right at the heart. We could say it's assumed throughout the entire book of Hebrews. So in that way, the only way Jesus is the great high priest and who is supreme over the priest of Aaron is because he has been raised from the dead. And our faith, it rests on the fact that Jesus is raised from the dead. Our faith depends on the fact that our God raises the dead. Like what we saw last week from Hebrews chapter 11, when we talked about the big picture of Hebrews and Hebrews 11. That chapter continually shows us all of these ways that people had faith in the midst of certain death or potential death. So our faith rests on the fact that God raises the dead. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus. Now, 1992, I was a new Christian when I came home for Thanksgiving my freshman year. And it was on that first Thanksgiving that I was a Christian that my grandfather passed away on Thanksgiving Day after a long battle with cancer. Now, for obvious reasons, on that Thanksgiving, that was a year that the reality of death and Thanksgiving, the reality of death was really heavy on us, obviously, but also just that Thanksgiving looked nothing like what we were used to. But for the very first time in my life, because I was a Christian now, I could look at death differently. Because of the resurrection from the dead, there was now hope. Like Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians, we don't grieve as those who have no hope. We have hope. And so though death threatens to erase the meaning from our lives, and it holds in slavery people to the bondage of the fear of death, as Christians, one of the great blessings and what we can be thankful for continually is we have been set free from this bondage to decay. We know though we will die, we will live. Listen to what Charles Spurgeon writes about Psalm 23:4. I've read this to a few people over this last week. I was so encouraged that Psalm 23:4, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Here's what Charles Spurgeon writes. No one is afraid of a shadow, for a shadow cannot stop a man's pathway even for a moment. The shadow of a dog cannot bite. The shadow of a sword cannot kill. The shadow of death cannot destroy us. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. That's the great hope we have. We can be thankful for the blessing that God has raised Jesus from the dead, and it gives us hope we will be resurrected one day with him. Blessing number three here that we can think about here this morning that we should be thankful for. God shepherds us through his son. God shepherds us through his son. Now, if the author of Hebrews were a student who maybe in high school English and they were writing a paper, and this author of Hebrews was a student and they were writing a paper and they came to the conclusion of their long paper and they introduced not just one new topic, but two new topics, I'm guessing that English teacher would be saying, whoa, 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 why in the conclusion of the whole thing are you introducing these new topics you haven't talked about? Like the resurrection, where you didn't say resurrection anywhere else. And the other thing that we haven't really seen explicitly again through the book is Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep. But this is where it helps us to remember that the benediction isn't just a conclusion to what we might say, that we're kind of wrapping up what we said and kind of repeating the main point. What it is it's a sending out and it's a reminder of the blessings that we have in Christ. It's a prayer of sorts that we would understand and live in light of these truths, that the God of peace, who has made peace through the blood of the Son, his Son, who he raised from the dead, that he's alive. And the fact that Jesus is alive, it shows us that he's active. He's not only active in making intercession, as the book of Hebrews talked about, but he's shepherding us. He's caring for us. He is our great high priest. He's also the shepherd of the sheep. Now, in earlier in Hebrews chapter 13, in this chapter, the author quoted Joshua 1:5, "Never will I leave you or forsake you." Now that was Moses, God's words to Joshua when Moses was passing the baton to him. And we remember the words of Jesus, "I will be with you always, even to the end of the age." The fact that Jesus is alive means he lives to shepherd us. As the one who conquered death and made peace through his cross, he is our greatest treasure, and now he's making intercession for us, and he's seeking for us to be following him. So he's our shepherd, and he's leading us. He's leading us beside still waters. And so we have this, whatever we could come to, whatever we fear, whatever comes, whatever happens, Jesus is supreme, and not only is he supreme in this majestic sense, he's supreme by being near to us. And so here's something I'd like to encourage us to do when we hear news that tempts you to be seized with fear. Now look, at any given point, at this point in our kind of just history, there are any number of things that we could be tempted to be fearful about. News that we hear that just kind of grips us and we wonder, what are we going to do? I just want to encourage us, Hope, Fellowship, let's be thinking here. Jesus is alive and he's reigning, which means our destiny is rock solid. It is sure. He's going to shepherd us and he's going to lead us to that point. And so that means we have a shepherd and we're not left in need. We are led beside still waters. We have a shepherd who restores our soul even when we go through grief and pain. And so we can just say essentially to ourselves when we're gripped with fear, I have such a shepherd and he is supreme. Well, the last blessing that we should be thankful for, I want us to look at here this morning, is God equips us with everything good that we may do his will. Now, look back with me at verse 20, and I want us to skip down to the end of, to the beginning of verse 21, because the rest of verse 20, so if you look at verse 20, now may the God of peace, now the rest of that verse is a description of what God has done for us in Christ. And so if we connect, if we kind of cut and paste, as it were, and take the beginning there and connect it to the beginning of verse 21, we could see this. Now may the God of peace equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. And so the in-between verses, they're describing Jesus and they're essential. But what we want to see is this God of peace, he's not just giving us blessings in Christ, he's also blessing us in Christ and he's working in us. And so notice there it says, equip you with everything good that you may do his will working in us. And so there's a connection of God's sovereignty and also our responsibility. God is working in us, just like he has created good works beforehand that we might walk in them that we see in Ephesians chapter 2. But we're also equipping you with everything good that you may do his will. And so we can follow him. Now, thinking about equipping here, I mean, it's when we start a new job, it's easy. One of the greatest challenges really is to kind of think about all the things that we don't know when we're starting that new job. And so I remember when I was in grad school, I did an office job, and the boss, it just seemed like week after week, he just wanted to sit there, and I was just watching over his shoulder how to run this new computer program and to do it exactly the way he wanted. You know, I had to learn a new computer program in order for the things to be done the way he wanted them to be done. Now, when we read in verse 21, now may the God of peace equip you with everything good that you may do his will, I don't think we should be just thinking of equipping merely in the way of like a new hire orientation or training. The equipping that's being spoken of here literally means to be made complete in every good thing. It's, you know, rather than think of a new job hire, new orientation, think of it more like somebody who's going on a mountaineering expedition. If they're going to be outfitted to climb icy peaks of the Alps, they're going to need to be outfitted with the right technical climbing gear. But more than that, they're going to need the right clothing. They're going to need the right strength training beforehand in order to have the endurance they need. To be truly outfitted as a climber, they're going to need the right mindset to be spending long hours on the side of a mountain with very little progress being made. It's a holistic equipping and outfitting that's needed for this person to be a mountaineer. To be made complete in every good thing. To be equipped. To be outfitted. That's what God is doing in us. This God of peace is equipping us. And so he wants believers, he wants you as a Christian and me as a Christian to be made complete with everything good that we may do his will. Now, I think we can easily get tripped over when we think about doing God's will. We can think about kind of what do you want me to be when I grow up? Or what can I do the will of God or make sure I'm in the will of God? What we have to remember here is this equipping, in complete equipping, it's to do his will in every area of our lives, in every circumstance that we find ourselves in. And so this equipping looks very different than just kind of a new hire or a new orientation or how do I do the will of God in this particular circumstance? It's in every area. You know, I talked to a friend this couple weeks ago. And I hadn't talked to him all throughout COVID. He's a pastor. And I knew his wife has leukemia. And we'd been praying for him. So the very first question I asked him was, how's your wife doing? And as we talked, and as they talked, he talked about how their marriage had been growing even through leukemia and through COVID. And here's what he said. He said, "We count it a privilege that God has chosen us to walk this path and to be able to suffer in this way for him in order to show his sustaining grace." And he repeated it. It's a privilege. We just feel overwhelmed with this privilege it is to suffer this way. Now look, I think putting it in the language here of Hebrews 13, they had been equipped by God with everything good in order to do his will for this moment that they find themselves in. So this is another reason we don't need to be anxious about that which we can't see or we don't know is coming. God's equipping us, and he's preparing us, and he's going to equip us to do his will even when we find ourselves in circumstances and situations that we have no idea how we would handle. If left to ourselves, how do we respond? But the equipping, made complete in every good way, God will enable us to even face pain and brokenness and death. And so here on this week of Thanksgiving, God has made us, he's given us many things through his Son that we can be thankful for. Far beyond just kind of statements that we might make kind of quickly just so we can dig into the turkey and stuffing, God has given to us great things we can rejoice in. We can be thankful. He's secured peace. He's raised his Son from the dead. He shepherds us through his Son. And he reminds us that he's equipping us. No matter what may come, he is equipping us to do his will. And we can be thankful for all these things. And so, Hope Fellowship, I'm thankful that God is at work even now, even when it's not the way we would prefer. God is working. Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you that you are doing your good work in us and through us. You have equipped us and you are equipping us for everything with everything good to do your will, even in such a time as this. And so, even in the midst of potential grief this week, missing loved ones, disappointment, frustration, all of these things that we could feel and are feeling or potentially feel, Father, we ask, would you help us to be thankful? Would you impress upon us, even in a greater way this year, the thankfulness we have to you for your Son? We give you praise that this message from the book of Hebrews is so clear. Jesus is supreme. May you be glorified. Amen.
All the follies of sin.
Well, for our benediction here, of course, let's use Hebrews 13. Now may the God of peace, may he equip you to do his will, may equip you with everything good to do his will, so that you might live thankful, delighting in his Son. He is shepherding us. He is caring for us. And we can walk in newness of life, following after him. Would you go in joy and peace with thankful hearts?